Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Trinity on this, the 17th Sunday after Trinity. Today we get a chance for us to consider our placement before God, our standing before Him. And sometimes it's very easy to look at ourselves, we look at our accomplishments, and to think of all of the wonderful things that we have done and that God has made us. And yet, it's a different thing to be humble before the Lord. This morning, Jesus has a lesson for the Pharisees and for us on humility and on what we call this great reversal, that Jesus brings low those whom He will exalt, and that He raises up those who, and that He brings low those who are exalted. May the Lord bless our worship together this morning as we begin with our opening hymn, Arise, O Christian People. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment, both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, in your mercy, grant your people grace to withstand the temptations of the devil, and with pure hearts and minds to follow you, the only God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our first lesson this morning comes from the Old Testament book of Proverbs, chapter 25. Do not honor yourself in a king's presence. Do not stand in a place reserved for great people, because it is better to be told, "Come up here," than for you to be humiliated before a ruler whom your eyes have seen. Do not be in a hurry to go to court. Otherwise, what will you do afterward when your neighbor humiliates you? Argue your case with your neighbor, but do not reveal someone else's secret. If you do, the person who hears it will shame you, and your bad reputation will never leave you. A word spoken at the right time is like golden apples in silver settings. To ears that listen, a wise person's correction is like a gold ring or like jewelry made of pure gold. To those who send him, a trustworthy messenger is like cooling snow on a warm day during harvest. He refreshes his master's spirits. A person who brags about a gift that is never given is like clouds and wind that bring no rain. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. For our psalm of the day, Psalm 116, our grades 3 through 8 of our grade school will sing their anthem. For our second lesson this morning, we turn to Paul's letter to the Ephesians in chapter 4. As a prisoner in the Lord, therefore, I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called. Live with all humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as also you were called in the one hope of your calling. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in us all. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time.
Alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia.
The Gospel according to Luke chapter 14. One Sabbath day, when Jesus went into the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat bread, they were watching him closely. Right in front of him was a man who was suffering from swelling of his body. Jesus addressed the legal experts and Pharisees, saying, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not?" But they were silent. So he took hold of the man, healed him, and let him go. He said to them, "Which of you, if your son or an ox would fall into a well on a Sabbath day, would not immediately pull him out?" And they could not reply to these things. When he noticed how they were selecting the places of honor, he told the invited guests a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not recline in the place of honor. Or perhaps someone more distinguished than you may have been invited by him. The one who invited both of you may come and tell you, "Give this man your place." Then you will begin with shame to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and recline in the lowest place, so that when the one who invited you comes, he will tell you, "Friend, move up to a higher place." Then you will have honor in the presence of all who are reclining at the table with you. Yes, everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. Please be seated for the hymn of the day. Peace to all of you who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. The word of God that we'll focus on this morning is the gospel of the day from Luke chapter 14. And I'd like to reread for you again just the very last verse of that text where Jesus says, "Yes, everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." This is the gospel of the Lord. Let's bow our heads and pray. O Lord, may the meditation of my heart and the word of my mouth be pleasing in your sight. For you, O Lord, are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, dear Christian friends, rest can be a very wonderful blessing, can't it? It's an important thing for all of us to have, for sure. And that's not to say anything bad about work. Work is a blessing too. A lot of times we need to be reminded of that, don't we? But rest is an important thing. It's a blessed thing. And we're given an indication of that already at the beginning, at creation itself, when God, after his work of creating the world was done, after those first 6 days, then on the seventh day, he rested. And it seems like such an odd thing to us, doesn't it? God didn't need to rest on day seven. It's not as though he was tired and that he needed to take a little breather before he went back to his all-important work of holding the universe together, as only God can do. That's not why he rested. He rested to set a pattern, a blessed pattern, for us, for his people. He rested so that he could bless rest, so that all of us would know and realize how important it is for our daily lives. And it didn't just end there, God blessing rest. He even gave us this pattern to follow in the Old Testament when he dictated to his people exactly when and how they were going to rest. He established the Sabbath day for them. It was the seventh day of the week, Saturday, and God's people were supposed to rest, stop doing their work, because rest is a blessing. We need it. Without it, we don't function properly. But there was a lot more to the Sabbath rest of the Old Testament than just rest for the body. God was also setting a pattern for our lives in another way. He was encouraging us to consider where we find rest for our souls. The Sabbath rest was important because it was on that day, in addition to all the rest for sure, but on that particular day, when people would hear the word of God, when they would find rest for their souls, which can only really be found in God alone. We see Jesus putting into practice this Sabbath rest throughout his ministry. And this is yet another text where Jesus puts it into practice and yet does it in a way that the Pharisees and others are questioning, what is this Sabbath rest supposed to mean? And is Jesus really following it? Dear friends, as we think about rest today, as we consider what a Sabbath rest is, may the Holy Spirit bless us that we might find only our true Sabbath rest in Christ alone. One of the challenges, I think, as you read through the Gospels is that you try to piece them together and understand why do things come in the order that they do. A lot of times it's chronological, but there are plenty of times when it isn't chronological. It's more thematic. Why do the gospel writers include exactly the events that they include? And this, I think, is one of those texts where you look at it and say, what does this Sabbath rest and a healing on the Sabbath day have to do with what Jesus teaches about right after that, about humility? It's actually, I think, a very important question in this text because I think they're very related, but it's kind of hard to see at first. You see, Jesus was observing the Sabbath rest like he did, the Gospels say, on every Sabbath. It was his pattern to go to the synagogue as he was supposed to. It was his pattern to find rest in the Word of God as he listened to that Word and then put it into practice. Now, the Pharisees, they had that custom as well. They kept the Sabbath day. They counted out their steps. They stopped from doing any kind of work on those days. They did what they thought was keeping the Sabbath. They rested. But were they really resting? That's the question we're kind of led to ask by the way that they act very differently than the way that Jesus acts on the Sabbath day. You see, for the Pharisees, it wasn't so much about rest for their souls. Instead, the Sabbath pridefully became this opportunity for them to show just how well they kept the law. It was another opportunity for them to parade their good works before other people, and if there were others who weren't keeping the Sabbath,
this track for Jesus in our text this morning. took on himself all
Please stand.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to you, O God, through your dear Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent to be our Savior, our Redeemer, and the messenger of your grace. Through him you made all things. In him you are well pleased. He is the incarnate Word, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. To fulfill your promises, he stretched
drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you on the cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven, and you are at peace with God. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you on the cross, for the forgiveness of all of your sins.
Take.
And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and preserve you in the one true faith until life and everlasting. Your sins are forgiven, and you are at peace with God. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you on the cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven, and you are at peace with God. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you on the cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven, and you are at peace with God. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you on the cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven, and you are at peace with God. Amen.
Thank you.
Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you on the cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven. And you are at peace with God. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Pour out for you and you are my blood, all of your sins are my soul. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven, and you are at peace with God. Until life everlasting. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you on the cross.
Please stand. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this saving gift. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated for the closing hymn. Good morning again, and welcome to everyone. A special welcome to the guests that are with us. We want you to know that you're always welcome here at Trinity Lutheran Church, and we pray that you saw Christ clearly in our service this morning. We especially want to thank the third through eighth graders for singing for our service this morning, proclaiming the gospel to us in song. Thank you to them. Thank you for the teachers for getting them ready. Thank you to the parents for bringing them and having them be a part of our service today. Just a couple of announcements to mark for you. We have Bible class this morning. We'll be in here as usual with Bible class going through the beginning of the reign of the kings in 1 Samuel. We hope you can join us for that. And this morning, Mr. Dahlke, our staff minister, will be teaching that Bible class as I will have the opportunity to teach a Bible class to the youth group for part of this time. So to the youth group, thank you again for their service as well. And we hope that you can join us for that for a Bible study there. We're going to be taking a look in that study on the roles of men and women. So we hope you can be there for that, youth group members.